That's more or less the reaction I've heard.
Ben, do you have slide control?
Good morning.
Hi, Ben.
I have slide control.
Wonderful. Do you want to do the intros?
Okay. Well, sure. Let's get started. So, welcome everybody to PPM. Thank you for Michael for volunteering to help us with minutes. As always, note well, participating in an IETF session such as this one incurs certain obligations on you. These are legal obligations, so it is important that you understand them. If you're not familiar with them, please familiarize yourself with them right now. In addition to those obligations, which principally concern intellectual property, there are also some norms of behavior. As always, I hope this won't be a problem, but if it becomes a problem, the chairs are responsible for making sure that everybody is on professional and collegial behavior. This is just an overview of some of the tools. Make sure to use the on-site tool so that we know who's participating. And here's our draft agenda for the session. If anybody has comments on this agenda, would like to make an adjustment, please come to the microphone now. I want to note particularly, just for everybody's awareness, that this working group has one assigned milestone, which is December 2023 to complete development of what was then called the PPM protocol. I think that we can fairly say that that is now the DAP protocol. So anybody with thoughts on that milestone is welcome to surface them. It seems a little bit ambitious to me, given our current progress. But on the other hand, I think we've actually made excellent progress toward that milestone, even if maybe we might not quite hit it. So the chairs will give that some thought. But if anybody wants to have input on that, please mention it to us here or on the mailing list. So that's all for the chair slides.
unless there's agenda bashing. No new agenda items? Wonderful.
Okay. In that case, we will hand it over to Chris.
Who's local?
Is this the mic you want me to use?
Yes.
Okay.
All right. Can folks online hear me?
Let's assume so.
Yes.
Don't complain if they can't.
Okay, cool. The goal here is basically, so I have 50 minutes. So this is basically time spent on kind of the nuts and bolts of the protocol. I do see a lot of new faces here, which is great, but this isn't going to be super relevant to anyone who hasn't read the protocol. But if, you know, I guess if you have questions about how the protocol works at any point, feel free to ask. We have plenty of time. So if I missed any issue that you feel is important to discuss, please bring it up as well. I'm going to go next slide. So what I've done is kind of like aggregate the kind of the main open issues and put them in an order that I feel is, you know, like biggest to like most niche. So this first one is actually corresponds to five issues that have been filed over the last year or so. Some of these are kind of bugs. Some of these are like, well, there's probably ways we can improve the communication cost. In support of a couple of use cases, a feature of DAP is that you can collect a batch of reports multiple times, each time with a different aggregation parameter. Does anybody want to ask what that means? Anybody in the room? Okay, we're going to move on, assuming everyone knows what I mean. So in particular, this is in support of a couple of use cases. So drill down, which we're going to talk about a little bit later on. This idea that you kind of want to poke at the data, look at it, look at different, like split aggregates in different ways. And then heavy hitters, which is, there's this VDEF called Poplar1 for which this this was defined. And you need to be, the idea is that you need to be able to kind of query a set of reports on a different set of candidate prefixes at each round of collection. So our requirements here are really security. Like there's, it is only safe to, there are only certain sequence of collection queries that are safe. And these are spelled out in the VDEF draft on a per VDEF basis. So we need to make sure that we're enforcing the conditions that are spelled out for the particular VDEF. Okay, so the core problem is, you know, we've envisioned these use cases in the draft, but we no one has implemented this. There are two existing implementations, both of which only implement Prio, and neither has tried to like flesh this part out in the design. So we folks have pointed out potential bugs. I think all we can do here is someone needs to implement this and then propose a PR to address any issues. And then another possibility is we just make DAP only compatible with Prio. So I wanted to stop here and see if anyone had a preference for either of these proposals or had an alternative in mind.
Anyone in queue?
Simon.
Hi, Simon Friedberger. I think let's just not do two because we still want heavy hitters. Also, I think there's a bit of an issue because you're saying collecting batches many times, but for drill down, you need to collect reports many times in different batches. Let's not throw it away.
Okay. I think you're right there.
Do we have anyone who is ready to implement?
I will implement this sometime next year if anyone doesn't get to it first.
Tim?
Yeah, we're definitely planning to implement this in Giannis at some point. It's not exactly clear when. We're very focused on shipping Prio-based use cases right now, but we definitely want to do this. It's tempting to kick everything but Prio out of DAP for the sake of the simplicity of DAP. I don't think I have a more developed thought than that. I'm not, I don't feel prepared to commit to like saying that it's a good idea right now. I suspect that like it's pretty close to being capable of doing, capable of running VDApps that have an aggregation parameter in multiple rounds. So on balance, I'd say leave it in.
Other thoughts? Okay, we're going to take proposal one here. Unless if anyone wants to object, please contact us on the list. Next slide. Okay. All right. So this has been kind of a pain point for a while now. So there's this need in the DAP protocol to have a batch selection logic. The idea here is the aggregators need a way to partition reports into distinct non-overlapping batches. And the way this is defined in the protocol is there is these query types. Basically, the collector gets to query the aggregators to get the aggregate for a batch of reports. So different semantics for like different strategies for different batch selection processes would be kind of formalized as different query types. We have two right now, time intervals, basically where the collector says, give me the aggregate for all of the reports between T1 and T2. And then you have fixed size, which is, I don't really care how you partition reports. Just give me a unique identifier for each batch of reports. So the problem here is that supporting multiple query types has turned out to be kind of a pain for implementation. I've noticed this in my own implementation. And if you look at the issue here, Brandon has a very long and very well detailed kind of treatise about why this is not a good idea. So the kind of the main observation is that this query type called fixed size is basically gives us all of the functionality we need right now. As long as you're willing to kind of capture different batch strategies as like out of band business logic that's implemented by the collector and the leader. So concretely, the idea is like, you can kind of emulate a time interval kind of semantics using just the fixed size query type. So go ahead, Tim.
So I think this has to be refined a bit, especially in light of some of the discussions we had at the last IETF, where like I brought forward the proposal of removing time interval queries from the protocol. At that time, there was some pushback on that, like some arguments that it was necessary. I don't want to misrepresent those arguments by stating them poorly, but I think, for instance, like one of the notions was that you need something like time interval to be able to align data you get through DAP with data received from like other metric systems. But I think what's being discussed here in my mind is not necessarily like removing time interval, right? Or trying to show that we can come up with some like flavor of fixed size that is equivalent in some respect. I think it's, or you tell me, Chris, I think what this proposal is about is like making the helper specifically agnostic to query types, right?
Yes, that's basically right. But the other thing we would do is remove kind of the query type logic from the protocol altogether. So all you have basically is you assign the leader assigns reports to batch IDs by some opaque strategy. The question is whether that's good enough.
Yeah, I wonder whether. I think we'd have to dig into whether you could still specify whether the leader should accept uploads, right? I guess you could write that text in terms of, what do I mean? Like currently in the time interval case, we say the leader should reject an upload if the timestamp falls within a span of time that has already been collected. I think we'd have to make sure that we can still reject reports appropriately if we remove that like the formal notion of time interval queries from the protocol.
Yeah, I think that we could.
I think that's all I have.
Couple people in the queue. Shan?
Hey, a related question. If we are removing the fixed interval type, can we also relax the fixed size semantics so the max size is optional?
I think we would just remove. I mean, we can make it optional. We could also remove it. I don't care which one we do. Do you have a preference?
I would prefer we still have it for the case where we want to limit the size of a batch, but also make it optional for the case that we don't care.
Okay. So I think we could work that out in a PR if we once we actually decide to take this, if we decide to take it.
Cool. Thank you.
Simon?
I'm happy with any improvements to performance and otherwise, but I would vote for proposal two here to do nothing at the moment because we have it specified. We are using it. So yeah, I think it just complicates things if we now decide that we don't need it and it should be out of band somehow.
So Mozilla is using this?
We are using time intervals at the moment, yeah.
I think then we should keep it. I think Daphne might remove this feature unless you ask us to keep it. But yeah, let us know. Okay, well, I mean, we have one person using it, I guess. That's news to me. Tim?
Yeah, thanks. Sorry, Simon's comment jogged my memory. So Chris, you made a point about complexity for implementations with respect to this proposal. And the thing is, to Simon's point, if time interval gets like downgraded to something that is like business logic sort of out of band specified between collector and leader, well, that means that implementations that want to do this like still have to carry the code that does it. Still have to deal with maintaining the code that does it. So I think that undermines like the argument that this like simplifies implementations, right? What I mean is, if we take this out of the spec, but if my implementation still has like a subscriber that wants to use time interval, then I don't actually get to delete any code.
So you'd have to, your subscriber has to like, you have to figure out how to emulate the emulate the same kind of thing in a world where you just have batch IDs and
reports. Yeah, I agree. And I don't think that that's impossible, but then I think the challenge for the working group doesn't become just like, let's remove mention of time interval from the protocol. I think it becomes incumbent on us to write out how would you achieve time interval-like semantics using fixed size.
We could do that. I think there's one other. Oh, hey, Ben.
Hi. Is there a simplification possible here if a given task config commits to one query type or the other rather than allowing both?
It already does.
Okay.
I think I'm hearing people are want to do proposal two. Does anybody object to sticking with two? Implementations do nothing, acknowledging that implementations are free to not implement query types they don't want to implement.
All right.
Cool. Next slide. Again, if anyone objects or has further comments, we can keep discussing it. Okay. Supporting drill down. So the idea is like you have your computing, you want to sort of like break down aggregate results by various properties of the client. So imagine you want like give me the sum for all user agents equals Mozilla or Firefox or whatever, or geolocation equals Prague. I don't know. So you have sort of like arbitrary labels assigned to reports. And you want to like be able to query the database for a given label or a given sequence of labels. There's obviously like, you know, we're getting into a territory where we're sort of wanting to like get something from like SQL that we're used to when we're interacting with databases. I guess like, you know, how much behavior of SQL you can emulate kind of depends on your threat model. So with this particular issue, the main objection that's been brought up is if clients are labeling their reports, well, they're you're adding potential to sort of like fingerprint clients. So like, how do we constrain the semantics of these labels such that they don't give us a way of kind of arbitrarily drilling down on data until we end up de-anonymizing, like learning the measurements for clients with a particular, very specific label. On the other hand, like, you know, you still want to enforce minimum batch size because in order to get some notion of privacy, you want to make sure that the anonymity set is still sufficiently large. So there's sort of like a weird kind of privacy usability trade-off space here that kind of gets complicated. But nonetheless, we can do this. So Tim wrote up like a concrete proposal for like adding labels to the report metadata, and we can discuss like how we actually like want to constrain this, if at all. I wanted to bring up another possibility. Tim also suggested, well, maybe like, is there a way to do the like split late aggregates by label in MPC? So we have been exploring this problem, and there will be a new VDAF proposed at CFRG on Thursday called Mastic. Mastic is a lot like Poplar One, except it has some additional functionality. In particular, it allows you to kind of like give me the you have like Prio like functionality, except you can break down the aggregates into, and you can kind of partition the aggregates for by label. So like, give me the sum for all clients with this label, give me the sum for all clients with this label, and so on. The neat thing here is that in doing so, you don't reveal which client has which label. So my claim, and I think we still need to do security analysis for this new VDAF, but my claim is that you can relax like the second requirement to enforce the minimum batch size because the anonymity set is still the same size. Tim?
Thanks. So in the Mastic scheme, if I'm doing a query that involves labels, does that get represented in the DAP aggregation parameter?
Yes.
Okay, so really what I'm getting at is if Mastic like has all the properties that we all hope it does, there shouldn't be any DAP level changes needed for it to work. Is that correct?
No. I think that we need to get the collect a batch multiple times thing right, but that's it.
Yeah, but that's like, we need to get that sorted out for any VDAF that has an aggregation parameter, but it's not like a Mastic specific problem.
Yep.
Okay, thanks.
So Shan, before we answer your question, I want to point out that this has limited functionality, so we might not be able to get every kind of query pattern we would ever want. So we're constraining how we can use the system, but it might be in a useful way. Okay, I see a long queue, so I'll stop talking and let Shan talk.
Hey, thanks. Can we not resolve this by just creating one task per label?
Yeah, so as Tim points out at the top of the issue, this doesn't scale very well if you have like kind of arbitrary labels. So I know you're a big fan of TaskProv, but like setting that aside, because not everyone is a fan of TaskProv, this might be easy in TaskProv, but in general, it might not be easy to kind of spin up a new task for every old label that you would have. So potentially, yes. But it's like, we recognize that there might be limitations with this approach alone if you have a lot of labels. Who's next?
Chris Wood.
We kind of face the same exact or a similar problem in Privacy Pass, where we have this potential to like add different labels to tokens, and doing so might like increase the fingerprinting surface.
Right.
But there's other ways to increase the fingerprinting surface. So for convenience, it's nice to be able to label things. That has been sort of the emerging argument. So I don't see any problem with one, even with the the labels are potentially fingerprintable argument, especially because clients are like the ones who are slapping on data on these labels and their control of what their fingerprint is. Like they could just choose to not put labels on reports. That's totally fine. It's up to a deployment to ensure like what their overall privacy story is and whether or not the data they're putting in labels is like, it contributes meaningfully to their fingerprinting surface. So I think we can safely punt on that. The complications with like how you need to issue your queries and what that means about what data you can collect, that like I think Tim noted in the issue, those are reasonable. But I think we can overcome them. So I think we should just do both, like continue on the Mastic stuff, get that VDEF working for us later on. But if there are legitimate use cases for this drill down right now based on labels, let's just go with proposal one to start.
Yeah. Yeah. So just like get the wire changes done in case we need them.
Yeah.
I like that.
Kunal?
Hi, Kunal Talwar. So I guess I just want to raise a concern that without having something like this, we have the nice property that a client is assured that the only thing that can be collected is an aggregate over a large set, and there's no risk of my data being personally released. Whereas as soon as we start doing this, there is a risk that you can, even with minimum batch size, you can do differencing attacks, you can do reconstruction attacks, which can break that promise from a client's point of view. And I think there is a risk of losing participation because of that. So I think I would urge caution here.
Thanks, Kunal.
Ben Case.
Ben Case, Meta. So I work on private as measurement proposals in the PAT-CG, and we have a use case where we would like to essentially have these labels. It's very helpful for supporting large label sets, but I think in the particular use case, the fingerprinting isn't so much an issue. It's a little different setup where a server like gives a client a request and gets back a report, doesn't know what's in it, but can then label it. And so it seems like the fingerprinting is a little less of a concern there. And the other thing I wanted to say is that on these concern that Kunal had, as well as this lower point here about like potentially overlapping queries here, I think that like just shifting toward DP and DAP is gonna help solve a lot of these issues, particularly the single client or re-identification attacks is like the right way to address that. And also, I think we would actually like to be able to support one report having many labels, and to do that in like a DP optimally way, where you actually might want many outputs for a particular report. And you know, if that number is sufficiently large, you know, you want to use some advanced composition for it. But I just want to kind of really like plus one. This is a really kind of useful functionality, and happy to kind of think more about some of the details on it.
Great.
Tim.
Thanks. Yes, so I just wanted to double down on what Kunal was saying, in that like this could be very powerful, this labeling functionality, in fact, as Ben just pointed out. But like, I'd say a challenge that we've had at DiviUp, where I work in deploying this stuff, is that there's a lot of sharp edges to this cryptography. Like there's a lot of things a lot of parameters you have to choose very carefully, or you have to think very hard about stuff. And whether you're undermining privacy if you like deploy this way instead of that way. So I don't know. I think we have to decide, as designers of this protocol, do we want it to be sort of safe? Like, do we want it to be resistant against misconfiguration? Or do we want to say like, yeah, well, there's this labeling stuff, or there's this differential privacy stuff, but like, you better employ some really talented cryptographers who can help you choose good epsilons, or like to help you figure out, you know, what the privacy set you'll end up with if you choose so-and-so set of labels is. I'm honestly not sure what the answer to that question is.
Anyone else in the queue?
Nope.
Could we do a hum? Our PPM's first hum, if I...
Simon's in the queue.
We can do it in the tool.
Oh, cool.
What do you want it to be?
Simon, you want to say something first?
So while Sam sets up the meetup code, maybe I think I said this in the issue already, that I think if you want to do fingerprinting, maybe... Or if you want to single out reports, the fingerprinting is not that important because the leader sees IPs and can use that. And also, I mean, a lot of the things that can be done with additional labels, you can also do if you implement the labels using separate tasks. So I really like Chris's suggestion of why not both.
Yeah, I mean, I think there's, we, with proposal one, I think we still have a lot of thinking to do because we want the flexibility, but we still want to be strict about enforcing like some like minimal anonymity set. But it sounds, I mean, like Ben's suggestion sounds to me like maybe we can kind of relax that a bit if we have something for differential privacy, which sounds right.
Yeah. To me. I mean, as Tim said, you know, there are lots of sharp edges and things
yes.
to configure, right? We're already punting on this in the draft by saying, we're not saying what the minimum batch size should be.
Yeah.
And I kind of agree that I don't want to get into the weeds with this and I don't want to figure out what the differential privacy parameters have to be if you're collecting the same report in 15
yeah.
different queries and you don't know with what else, but it seems like a more useful way forward.
Yeah, so let me just say for, so I think the scope of the hum should be like, maybe we don't solve all of this at once, but we add the wire changes that are needed in order to support this. So like, should we do that is, I think.
Should we add labels?
Yeah, should we add label to the report labels to the report metadata?
Take Shan from the queue.
Oh, okay. Yeah, go ahead, Shan.
Just a very quick comment. Simon and many others have mentioned there are other ways to fingerprint already, but I think most of the other fingerprinting threats can be addressed by some separate technology like OHTTP to get rid of source IP. But the labeling fingerprinting is inherent with the whole aggregation process. I think it's once we introduce that, it's harder to mitigate than things like fingerprinting from source IP or connection.
Yeah, so totally agree. OHTTP won't help you if you send labels and those get passed through, but that doesn't mean that we can't figure out a way to balance the labels with the DP.
Fair enough.
Right, so the question is, are we making the wire changes to add the labels?
Yep.
See if that poll on the screen behind you, Chris, matches what you like.
Yeah, that looks good to me.
Great.
If I could just like elaborate on what Simon was saying earlier, labels or not, you can still do exactly the same fingerprinting by just giving each, like for each like unique label partition or permutation, you create a unique task. So labels are like purely a convenience thing. There's like no difference between what we have now and DAP with labels, like exactly the same misuse probability. So this is like purely aesthetic. For the example I gave was like, say you want like two labels, one as user agent Chrome, one as user agent Firefox. You could just implement that by saying there are two tasks. The first task is for Firefox. The second task is for Chrome. Done.
It depends on how complicated you get with the queries. So what if you wanted to know the aggregate for the intersection of the clients who share some feature?
Is that like a feature here? Like you want to be able to support like?
That's how I took Ben's suggestion, but I could be wrong.
Okay, well, I think that does complicate things a little bit, but perhaps we need a little bit more specificity in terms of like what it means to add labels. But I just assumed it mean like a label was just a way to like refine a task.
Yeah, which is why the question here right now is not to necessarily drill down on the complete semantics of labels, but just to say, like, let's add the wire change so that we can implement the wire change and we can use it later on if we need it.
Yeah.
Bearing in mind, folks, that there are organizations who are wanting to ship this like very soon. So we want to get the wire changes done that we will eventually need if we can.
To be clear, like people can still ship this without this being an RFC. Like that shouldn't prevent people from shipping it. We could sit on this for 5 years in draft and still ship it. That's fine.
Jonathan, you want to go to the mic? Actually, Jonathan, you want to wait in queue and then go to the mic? Gotcha. I'm going to close this poll, if only for the aesthetic reason of people seeing this proposal in front of them in the room again. And let's take the rest of the queue. Kunal?
So yeah, I guess just wanted to address Chris. I think while a single label definitely can be addressed by, I mean, can be handled by having multiple tasks, when you have a bunch of different labels, it's very easy to, I guess it's not transparently possible to simulate all of that large collection of features, and you can actually do much more of a combinatorial set of queries if you have multiple labels and something like this. So I think it does increase the attack surface of the kind of queries you can make. Yeah.
Tim?
It might be sort of moot since, judging from the show of hands results, it doesn't seem like, well, I'll let the chairs pronounce. But anyway, I just wanted to make the point that, like, what we're talking about here is whether to do plumbing changes to add labels, right? I think we're not talking about designing and specifying a query language over those labels, because I think that's a much harder problem that I'm less enthusiastic about tackling. It feels like we'd be doing enough plumbing, right, to allow the labels to appear so that, like, possible implementations could do something with them.
Unfortunately, Ben and I are not in person where we're not whispering to each other here as efficiently as I would like. I'd like to understand more of the no's. We had about a 50-50 split among those responding to this poll. I'd like to understand that no position better of why not make this wire change. Even if you've spoken on that, would you say more? Shan?
I wouldn't know, because I think this just opens a possibility of more attack. I just having it in the standard, even though we're not going to use it, but I think it's just I don't think we should put it in the standard until we figure out the impact on privacy. That's my stand.
But just to be clear, Chris, I think, is about to say the same thing as I am, so I'll let him say it.
Let's very quickly say, can we just, like, punt this to perhaps a separate draft that defines, like, an extension for labels and then, like, work on it there? Like, you don't have to block the main draft on this. You don't have to solve this now, but, like...
That's true. It could be treated as an extension.
I mean, it's literally...
extension would be fair.
Yeah. Would that be okay?
Does anybody who wants this feature, would you be okay implementing it as a report extension? Jonathan?
So this is just a straight question, because I don't understand the issue. Is if I... I wrote it down. Does combining labels make more information available than just having multiple tasks? Because in my understanding, reports from different tasks are not bound together, whereas labels you can bind together, because otherwise combining is sort of meaningless.
A report is bound to a particular task, so it can only be processed in a given task.
So Chris's suggestion that labels and tasks are the same is not true then, because you can't combine tasks because they're separate. But
it is true in the sense that if you want to emulate, like, aggregating by label, then you have a different task for each label.
And combining labels?
That's not possible.
Then I don't understand your last line on the slide, where you explicitly combine labels.
That's a mastic feature. That's not a feature of Prio on its own, in any form with DAP currently. There's issues to get through. I don't know if we're having the most productive conversation about this. I don't know if everyone has enough context. I want to suggest that we take it off list and try to reach consensus on doing this as an extension. Does anybody object to, or does anybody else want to say anything else on this topic? Cool. Cool. All right. Next slide then. So now we're, this is kind of the last meaty one. The rest are going to be kind of nitpicky-ish. So there's a desirable property of DAP is that honest parties that execute a task agree on the parameters of that task. In fact, this is sort of a requirement, basically. Like an honest client, in our threat model, you might have the collector and one of the aggregators doing something malicious and actively attacking the protocol. But as long as one server is honest and correctly executing the protocol, then you have privacy. So the question is, how do honest parties know that they agree on what the task parameters are? So think things like minimum batch size. How does the client know that an honest aggregator is enforcing the minimum batch size it wants it to enforce? Go ahead, Tim.
Well, sorry, I wanted to let you finish the slide before I jump in.
Okay. Well, there's three things that have been suggested for how to like what we want is basically like some guarantee that if I'm executing the protocol, then honest parties agree on the task parameters. One way to do this is there are these bits in task prov, which is going to be presented later on, where we basically derive the task ID that kind of identifies the task from the task config itself. So that implies if you and I compute the same task ID, then we also have the same task parameters. One suggestion is that this is a nice feature of this draft, and maybe we can pull it out in some form, perhaps move it into the core protocol or do something else. Another proposal is just, you know, pick the parameters that we feel are most important to have agreement on, and add those to the AAD for HPK encryption. That way you have a cryptographic binding to those specific values. By the way, you have the same exact thing with proposal one. It's just more general because the task ID is part of the AAD for HPK encryption. And then the third proposal would be basically more or less what we have today, but we might need to refine the text a bit. Basically just say there must be some mechanism that guarantees that honest parties agree on the task configuration. Does anybody not understand the problem statement here? Anyone online?
Tim or Nick, are your hands up to say you don't understand?
Yes.
Go ahead, Nick.
The issue 500 in the repo is making privacy relevant task parameters visible to clients. Is that also what you're talking about here, or is this a separate?
That I believe is. I'm basically what I try to do is boil down. This is an attempt to kind of concisely restate that problem. But if you disagree, let me know.
Well, it just seemed like a agreement on the parameters and making the privacy relevant parameters visible to clients seemed like different things to me. But if they're the same, that's good to know.
Well, you could, I guess, refine this statement to agreement on privacy sensitive task parameters.
Or maybe Nick just wants to say that the agreement is not just between the aggregators, but also with the client.
Yeah, that's the goal. That's absolutely the goal. Honest parties, that is clients or aggregators.
All right. You're not about saying it's not clear, right?
It is.
Go ahead. Jonathan.
Is it a requirement the client understands what the parameters are, or just that it agrees on them?
It would understand what they are. Everything in the task config is sort of spelled out and has well defined.
Because like an opaque blob is, I can agree on it even if I don't know what it is.
There are no opaque blobs.
All
Is Tim still in the queue?
Tim's still in the queue.
Yes.
But I think he has an opinion on the resolution.
So, unless he yells at me, go ahead, Chris.
I was going to say I like proposal two. In particular, it's not clear to me that this is necessary for every single deployment of this. So again, you could just sort of make this an extension that is then fed into the AAD for HPK encryption. And then in that extension, you describe what the relevant semantics are.
Cool.
That seems like a pretty clean way to handle this. And it would be an extension that falls out of task provisioning, which, as you said, attempts to do a little bit more.
Yep.
In fact, you could probably build task provisioning on top of this existing extension by adding some more stuff.
I suppose you could.
It's not intuitive to me that this should be an extension.
Just have an extension that says like parameters, and then it has the values in it, and then all the reports carry that, and that's part of the AAD. Right? I mean, that would.
So I think the task prov extension already accomplishes its goal. It already accomplishes kind of bind all task parameters to the task ID.
Yes.
So I don't think there's, and that is a proper report extension.
Yes.
So I don't think there's anything to do there. This would just be like useless work from the perspective of task prov, like, or redundant work from the, but it's not very expensive. So I have no objection to it's, number two.
I think task prov, as you said, is again, trying to do more. So this is taking out the piece that just solves this particular problem out of task prov and treating that as just a single extension. And
yep.
Task prov, you would layer on top.
Shall we take Tim finally?
Thanks. I think we should do proposal number four, nothing. So as Chris Patton laid out, none of the proposals that are here like change the fact that you still have to assume that like the aggregators are honest, right? So even if we do something to sneak like task parameters into the AAD or such, any aggregator can just like lie about what parameters it's using. And again, as Chris argued, like this still relies upon the privacy model of DAP, which is honest aggregators. So unless there's some like cool cryptographic construction that I'm not aware of, where you do get like some binding between task parameters and what the aggregators are doing, such that like it's impossible for them to defect, I don't think it's worth adding stuff to the core DAP protocol, right? So like particular deployments, if they want to do like, as TaskProf does, if they want to do something that introduces that binding, then and to some extent like proves at least agreement amongst all the participants, then like neat, but DAP makes the choice to like leave task parameter negotiation out of the spec. So I don't know why we would bring like this one little piece of task parameter negotiation into the spec.
Cool. Let that be a number, proposal number four. So any other votes? Shannon?
Shannon, thank you.
Oh, sorry.
So my vote is number one, but you can say I'm biased. I think number one is slightly more flexible. It defines the task config. Any new parameters you want to add to the task config, it will automatically be agreed upon between the client and aggregators. But I can imagine you can achieve similar things with proposal two. But just to respond to what Tim said a bit earlier, why do we need to do this negotiation? I think it's not about negotiating a parameter that's bulletproof. I think it's a lot about transparency and auditability. So the client can see what parameters that it has agreed to and opted into. So the client has the choice to either not opt into or, you know, they can find out if something, some dishonest aggregator is sending them really wrong privacy parameters.
Thanks.
Simon. No, I agree with Shan. Both one and two seem good. And they're both free on the wire and just clear up the situation. So
I'm going to take that as a vote for two.
I wanted to clarify something in response to what Tim said, which is do nothing. I think my suggestion for proposal two was to make it an extension, which means it is not part of the core spec, which can be considered do nothing, because you would define the separate extension, which describes like what the parameters are and then how that's bound to the AAD. And I think that like is two and four. in a way. Like, does not affect the core spec.
Do this, but then an extension.
Yeah, exactly.
That would be technically a little tricky.
Why?
Because, so your AAD that you're constructing today includes the report. Oh.
It also includes the report metadata, doesn't it?
Yeah, and you could just stick your privacy sensitive parameters right in there.
Right.
Chris is right, as always.
No, not always.
Although, if I understand Chris correctly, that would also require actually sending those things over the wire then, which doesn't add anything.
It would. You could. There's a couple things I think you can. Go ahead.
Oh, I understood two to also be sending it on the wire, but it's just is that two is not sending it on the wire?
Yeah, you could. You could do it either way. I don't see a. You would, I guess, like if you were sending it on the wire, you would also want the aggregators to like check that it has the right value. So
yeah, that was my mental model for this. But yeah. I guess I heard Simon just say was that number two is just like you literally just put it in the AAD, but you don't send it on the wire. You just like assume that the other person is going to use the same value and decrypt
successfully. Putting it on the wire sounds simpler.
It also addresses the transparency concern that I think Shannon has really been advocating for.
Yeah.
But again, maybe that points to like perhaps we don't have a shared understanding of what the problem is we're trying to solve here. If it's just transparency, then something needs to go on the wire. I don't know, Shan, if you can say what is the most important problem that you're trying to solve here, that would be helpful.
Yeah, for me, transparency is the client can see what price parameter has been decided for a task. So if the minimum batch size is one, then something is wrong. As a client contributing to a task, I want to know these parameters.
Simon, you're still in the queue? Oh, Tim.
What was I going to say? Right. On the task prop question, Chris Patton, since you're one of the authors, I think you can double check my thinking here. But like, I want to make the point that the you can't just like for free hoist what's added in task prop into the main document and get agreement on like task IDs. In particular, like task prop specifies that participants have to out of band negotiate this like this one bit of randomness from which they'll generate all the VDEF verify keys. So like that now suddenly we're tugging on this thread and stuff and like there's some like tangled knots on it. I'm worried that if you take some of the bits of task prop that do like the parameter agreement and hoist them up into DAP, now DAP is telling everybody like, no, thou shalt pre-negotiate this like bit of randomness from which to generate task parameters. And suddenly DAP is much more opinionated about like how you negotiate tasks than it ever was before. And I think we ought to avoid that.
Which is what's nice about too, right? We already declared that everybody has the information that they need. If we just add it to the AAD of the encryption, we don't need to transmit it. And we will still notice whenever somebody disagrees because the reports won't decrypt anymore.
Yeah, I tend to agree. Like if we're going to do anything, adding stuff to AADs is like relatively simple and doesn't increase message sizes, which is nice.
Okay, so I think I'm hearing a majority for doing nothing.
Doing nothing and then like double underlining that extensions can do whatever they want here. And task prov is like proof, implemented proof that you can do this stuff if you want.
Yep.
All right.
That work for you?
I think so.
Cool. All right. We're going to do nothing here. We just have a few minutes. Is there any way to get a little more time?
There is. Go ahead.
Okay, cool. Next slide then. I don't even know what it is. Oh yeah, okay. I hope this one is easy to resolve. Yeah, I don't know. Let's find out. Okay, so a batch mismatch is a condition where the two aggregators don't agree on the set of reports that are included in a batch. This leads to the following problem. Basically, you can't, your aggregate shares, when you add them up, they're just gonna add up to garbage. So this is like a fatal state where you can't recover the aggregate for a batch of reports. What we've done is add plumbings to kind of detect this. We'll talk a little bit more about the mechanism in a bit. And we've also taken measures to make this condition less likely. So it can still happen. So if one of the aggregators kind of like loses, like gets its state corrupted or something like that, then you're going to end up with a problem. But we hope it's rare. My proposal would be to do nothing and close this issue. An alternative is we can try to think of a mechanism whereby the leader figures out which reports are missing and resend them and try to recover. So right now we're just doing detection. Do we also want error correction? Go ahead, Simon.
Does the mechanism that we have cover this kind of DOS attack where I occasionally send a report that decrypts for the leader but doesn't decrypt for the helper?
Yes. So that report would be rejected. So if everything goes well during the aggregation flow, then you're just going to remove that report from the set. Does anybody object it to doing nothing here and closing the issue?
Mark, are you trying to get into the queue?
I'm fine.
You're in the queue. So, naive question here.
What's your last name, Mike?
Mike Bishop. Naive question here, but if we can detect it, and we already have a case where reports get rejected, would it not make more sense to have the report drop the ones that are mismatched and just indicate that there was a mismatch?
So I believe what you're asking is, what are you asking?
So is there a mechanism when we can detect batch mismatches? Do we know which reports are missing?
We don't.
And could the leader not just start over anyway, or would it have to be resubmitted?
That would be proposal number two. So like if right now that's not possible, you can sort of maybe do something hacky and very inefficient. The helper is supposed to reject reports that it's seen before. Okay. So if you resend all of the aggregation jobs and all of the reports that get marked replayed, you just assume that was in there. And actually, no, that technically could work, but it would be very ugly. We would want to do something better, I think.
I'm inclined to say if we can detect the mismatch and mark the report as this may be invalid, that's fine. But
so you're inclined to just do detection and or okay. Thanks.
Tim?
It feels to me like proposal number two isn't really like fleshed out enough for us to be able to have opinions on it, you know? Like I think we would need like not a completely worked out or much less implemented, but something more concrete, like what are these mismatch? I guess expanding on Mike's question, like what are the mismatch scenarios that we envision and what do we think we could possibly do about them? So then we could assess like, well, how hard would that be to implement? And the other thing that kind of, I also worry that there might be some like surprising privacy attacks here. Cause like suppose either aggregator is malicious and then is like pretending to not have reports or whatever. Maybe the helper is like, maliciously failing to do aggregations in an effort to get the leader to try to resend it like the same batch aggregation multiple times, but with just like plus minus one report to try to do some differencing attack. I don't know. Like I worry that this could be a very nuanced area. So we need more, I think we need more concrete proposals of what to do about it to assess them.
I agree with that. I think that we actually have the way we do report partitioning today is sufficient to defeat differencing attacks that might come up. But I agree this is not fleshed out. So the task would be if we want to do something, the question here is like, do we want to do error correction in this case? And then we would try to figure out someone who's willing to do the work.
And what I've heard is no. Although if someone does it, we wouldn't automatically turn them away.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, absolutely.
And you've got about four more issues and about 10 more minutes.
Okay, cool. We're going to take one right for now. All right. Two protects them. Speaking of the mechanism whereby we learn if we have a batch of mismatches, we compute this thing called a checksum. This is basically like an XOR of the hashes of a bunch of report IDs. Kind of a weird thing, I acknowledge. This is not part of like attacking this, like the cryptographic security of this thing. There are like algebraic attacks you can do, but this is not really in our threat model. Well, I do pose the question here, should it be in our threat model? It's not right now, but we can consider doing something about this for defense in depth. Okay, I think I did this in the wrong order. So the reason we have this checksum is to detect batch mismatches. The implementers feel this is necessary and useful to still have in the protocol, so we don't want to get rid of it. So there's a few proposals for what to do. Martin Thompson would like to make this cheaper, and he has some ideas for how to do that. He has a proposal there. Chris would suggest we can make it optional, like just have this be something that's like lifted out of the message and like added to like the query parameters for the URI. Or my proposal would be to do nothing, because compared to the crypto bits that are around this, it's relatively inexpensive.
And I note that Martin's not in the room.
Martin is not in the room.
He walked by a moment ago. We didn't come in.
Tim?
So I have an implementation that already does this. So like that introduces a bias in my mind. But I would be in support of, say, I think supporting Chris Wood's proposal, which would be to take it out of the spec, but then implementations could still stick it in either a query parameter or like in a header in the HTTP requests and responses. So you could still do it. And then we have, yeah. Okay. But I also wouldn't mind leaving it in, because then my implementation's already complying with the specification.
Are you leaning in either direction?
I think if you like, you know, force me to choose, I think I would lean towards, taking it out and then like having implementations put it in a header if they choose.
Cool.
Just cause I don't think we have like a super, super strong argument for keeping it in.
Okay. Any other opinions? Simon?
We also don't have a super strong argument for doing anything.
I agree. So you would say do nothing.
And the chief proponent for taking it out is not in the room.
I really would like to resolve this today, because it's, I think that we're overblowing this personally, and I think we should do nothing. I don't know if I'm supposed to state my opinion at the mic when I'm, sorry. Strike that from the record.
They're just gonna have an opinion.
Then let's do nothing. I think nobody has really said like, we must do something.
Simon?
Yeah, and to clarify, I think the point that Martin was making in the issue is that it was more expensive than other options, but it's still pretty irrelevant in the grand scheme of that.
All right, we're going to do nothing.
Next.
Okay. This is the bike sheddy one. So we, in the spec, we do things that deviate from TLS syntax. I want to quickly justify the thing you see on the left. I am following something that I saw in RFC 8446. That aside, we have some like workarounds for the limitations of TLS syntax if you do a strict interpretation of it. So some have suggested we should extend it in a way and like define our own semantics somewhere. The other option, of course, is to just fully comply with the TLS syntax, perhaps at the cost of more verbose language, or three, do nothing and just like explain the deviations when they arise and try not to do this too often. Preferences?
As I recall, the substance of the deviations here is like, as you illustrate on the left-hand side, on the left-hand side of your slide, it's just a couple of places where we instantiate like literals or partial literals of objects, which say, you know, so-and-so field equals to. My suspicion, not having tried it, is that it would take like a paragraph or two to explain what the, you know, extensions to TLS syntax are. So I think we should just do it in DAP and resolve it that way. As an implementer, I haven't found this to introduce like challenging ambiguities in terms of the message formats. So I think it's just a couple paragraphs to explain how we deviate from RFC 8446.
Cool.
if one was an IETF thing, that would be nice. Then we could just extend it there and use it. Otherwise, I'm also fine with just doing a one-off here. And for that specific case, I think you might even just, you flip it around, you put the two in front and you put the rest in the comment, and then you're sort of just using a constant.
Yeah, speaking as a DAP editor, I don't want to have to add another dependency to this draft, like writing down language somewhere. I forgot to mention, Chris, go ahead. Whoever's next.
I'm going to let Shan go.
Shan.
Hey, I think for the particular problem on the left, it's just assigning a value to an object rather than defining a new specification. I think we can probably resolve it by just writing pseudocode or something in the text.
So Shan is saying number one, but do it in the draft. Chris?
Yeah. Chris.
Yeah, sorry. One of the issues that was opened up and closed recently was the bike shedding about the width of a particular field in the packet format, which is like a pretty epic bike shed at this particular point in time. So we just closed it. But it does point to sort of the wire format syntax we're using here for TLS, which is very rigid about like how wide things are on the wire. Other protocols like OHTTP and whatnot have like moved away from TLS syntax to QUIC's like variable length encoding. And I'm wondering what people think about just pivoting the entire like wire format of DAP to something that supports variable length integers. So we kind of avoid this like deviation from TLS syntax altogether, but also potentially resolve like, how wide should this thing be? Do we have enough space for this? And blah, blah, blah. Not like a strong advocate for it, but like it has been like a trend in other protocols. I'm just curious.
I think it would be quite a bit of work to change the wire format at this time, at this point, but I don't object in principle. Like, I'm willing to do that work if we think it's the best idea.
Is it like, obviously it's implementation work.
Yeah.
But spec work. Are you suggesting that would also be a lot, or?
No, I'm thinking about the implementation primarily. Yeah, cool. Yeah. Does anybody want to go back to square one with the wire format, as Chris suggests? Chris has a concrete.
I'm like happy to like take a stab at a PR just to see what it would look like. Don't have to do it, but I don't know.
Can you take that as an action item so we could all look at it?
Yeah, sure.
Okay.
Chris, what are you suggesting? Are you suggesting we use the same syntax but different wire format, or completely different spec?
Quick syntax and wire format is different. In particular, it allows you to encode like integers and particular numbers in a variable length format. So like the width of, say, a report ID or a report share error may not always be like 2 bytes or 1 byte or whatever it is now.
I see.
And so it can end up being like more space efficient depending on like what you actually put in the packet itself. It does allow for more experimentation with things because you have a wider range of like
bits. We actually have a lot of like, we do a lot of 32-bit prefixing just because there's big messages. And we didn't want to do U20, like 24-bit prefixing.
Right.
So I think actually we would benefit quite a lot from like in terms of bandwidth, but you know, it's like, let's say 10%, like optimistically, it's not going to be a ton, but we would benefit in terms of communication.
And again, like, you know, the bandwidth is not like the primary like cost here, or I don't think it's the primary cost here, but so to some extent this might be aesthetic, but like I'm mostly just like trying to avoid potential bike sheds, and that feels like it's a way to sidestep some of them.
If it gives us a way to resolve things like this, I think it would be an improvement.
Okay,
these aren't necessarily about like wire, like size bike sheds, but Chris will take a stab at it and we'll see what it looks like.
Thanks, Chris.
Great, thank you.
We've got two more.
All right, let's do it. Next slide. I think I should let the other guys go though. So we're going to just, I want to suggest we do nothing here because the conversation's too complicated.
Great.
All right. 4:59, do nothing.
if you need to bring it back.
Next one. So this is, I suggest we just take proposal one, add the report ID, and make this a put instead of a post, and we could resolve this one. Chris, thoughts? Wish Ecker was here to defend it. Oh, go ahead, Tim.
Wait, sorry, I'd have to reread RFC 9110, but no, put seems appropriate to me because it connotes to the, it connotes clearly that this is idempotent, which means you're allowed to try to retry the same.
Oh, right, yeah. No, no, so the proposal is put and then add the report ID to the path, and that would resolve it.
That's right, that's right. Wait, sorry, who currently chooses the report ID?
The client.
Oh, yeah, it's just that it's in the report metadata instead? Okay.
Yep.
Yeah, okay, but I'm fine with that. Let's just make sure to hoist it out, to not state it twice then.
Okay.
Put it only in the request path and not in the report metadata.
All right, we did it. Thanks, everybody.
Mark.
Oh, go ahead, Mark. Oh no.
Mark's not in the queue.
Hello.
Don't over-rotate on the word replacing. I don't know what your use case is because I've been busy. What are you doing? If I were to do this and then right afterwards I was to do a get, would I get that representation back?
The protocol does not define a get for this resource. You just put it.
All HTTP resources should have get.
Okay.
All children should be.
It'd be great to get your feedback on the draft.
Okay. If that's the case, then post sounds like it might be okay.
Okay.
But don't replace it. Put is, put isn't quite replacing. It can be updating too.
Okay. Generally, like the second put would be rejected. So the one when we put this report, it would only be put once or posted once.
That sounds very good.
Chris, that's not true. You're allowed to put the same report multiple times because otherwise it would be impossible for clients to retry to usefully retry uploads. That's why it's a put in the first place.
I think we're running out of time for the other talk, so we're gonna have to take this offline.
Good job identifying a conversation to have. Junye, Ben is sharing the slides. If you really want to control them, you could share them instead, but otherwise you're on.
Yeah, I'm okay with you sharing the slide.
Great.
By the way, can everyone hear me? Okay.
Yes, go ahead.
Okay, I'll get started. Hey everyone. Today I'm going to introduce applying differential privacy to DAP. Next slide, please. In IETF 117, we kicked off the discussion of DP on DAP. And to reiterate the motivation of DP, keeping the measurements private as DAP does may not be enough for privacy. The aggregate result may still leak information about an individual's measurement. For example, if we were to collect the average height of the group of people on the right picture, the result may still leak information about the extremely tall person. Differential privacy can mitigate this problem because it provides a nice property that collecting an aggregate result with DP should not change significantly if any one measurement is replaced by another. This is achieved by adding noise to the measurements from the clients and to the aggregate shares by the aggregators. Next slide, please. DP is a class of definitions, such as epsilon DP, epsilon delta DP, and et cetera. And each of them can be the preferable one depending on the application. What DP guarantee you get against a particular adversary is a function of what information is available to the adversary. Therefore, we need to define trust models we aim to achieve DP in. Next slide, please. With these motivations in mind, we have published a new individual draft that addresses the feedbacks from IETF 117 and summarizes our requirements for DP on DAP. To name a few, we want to choose a class of DP notions that are suitable for DAP. For example, pure epsilon DP, approximate epsilon delta DP, et cetera. We want to define trust models we aim to achieve DP in. We have refined interfaces for DP mechanisms, which are responsible for generating noise. We have refined interfaces for DP policies, which are implemented with DP mechanisms and composed with VDAFs to achieve DP in the aggregate result. We also want to describe concrete use cases of applying DP on DAP. In the first version of this draft, we have shown one use case of collecting histogram with different DP policies to achieve the same degree of DP. Next slide, please. We hope our audiences of this draft are DAP deployments who want a cookbook for making their applications differentially private. This includes implementing the DP mechanisms and choosing the right DP policy for a particular application. We would also like to involve DP researchers and domain experts because we believe the integration of DP on DAP will be an iterative process between research and production deployment. Next slide, please. The first section in the draft aims to standardize DP definitions that are suitable for DAP. We have introduced two of the most common DP definitions, one being the pure epsilon DP, where epsilon describes the privacy loss of observing the aggregate result when there's a change in one element of the batch of client measurements. And smaller epsilon means stronger privacy. The second definition is the approximate epsilon delta DP, which relaxes epsilon DP with a small delta that describes the probability of information leakage. Allowing for a small delta can allow randomized algorithms to add less noise. And smaller delta means stronger privacy. The exact definitions can be found in the draft itself. We aim to include more definitions of DP that make sense for DAP in the future as well. Next slide, please. Along with the definitions, we also want to define trust models to account for attackers, where we aim to achieve DP in. We consider attackers that participate in the upload and aggregation protocol and can corrupt parties like clients and aggregators. In a draft, we define three increasingly pessimistic trust models. The first one being one aggregator and most clients are honest, or in short, OAMC. The DP policies designed for this trust model usually have good utility, and the DP guarantee provided by these policies usually degrades gracefully as the number of honest clients decreases. And we also know this is the same trust model as core DAP when all clients are honest. The second trust model is when one aggregator and one client is honest, or in short, OAOC. In this trust model, our goal is to protect the privacy of the only honest client. And the last and the most pessimistic trust model is when only one client is honest, or in short, OC, where the achieved privacy from the only honest client is usually much weaker. Next slide, please. We also define hedging, which is a desirable property for a DP policy to still maintain some degree of privacy when its assumptions about trust model turn out to be false. For example, in this diagram, the green elements are the honest parties. If a DP policy aims to achieve the desired epsilon DP in the OAMC trust model, and a deployment turns out to be OAOC, it is desirable for a DP policy to still provide some degree of privacy. That is a weaker epsilon prime DP, where epsilon prime is much larger than epsilon. Next slide, please.
Ben Case, do you have a clarifying question?
I have a question on the
Vin City has a question on the threat model slide. Do you want it now or later?
Sorry, I couldn't hear his question.
Sorry, I had a question on the threat model slide, but I don't know if you want to go through all your slides and then take questions.
Sure, we can take that question afterwards, yeah. Or we can take it now since we already flipped this slide.
Yeah, so on this one, this is a good overview of threat models. And I just want to maybe ask about the scope here. So I understand that DAP has made some decisions to be a two-party protocol, but this group might also be interested in VDAFs that are potentially three-party. I know Martin has certainly told you guys about IPA, which uses a three-party honest majority malicious MPC. And so I want to just kind of know if that's something that would be interesting to put in a document like this, if we're looking kind of like as a longer term sort of research, you know, document that starts to kind of try to capture some other threat models that may be of interest to different folks. And I'm also happy to volunteer if some work like that needs to be done.
Sure. I think we welcome contribution from other trust models. You mean when we define trust model, we should define for like, say, when more than two aggregators are in the protocol?
That's right. This would be the setting where there's three aggregators and you trust that all pairs of two are honest, but you get malicious like active security.
I see. I think currently we'll describe how like a concrete DP policy will work with the VDAF. So I think we can certainly account for those if there is use case. Chris, I don't know if you have anything to say.
Yeah, just speaking as an author, I would like to keep this document focused on threat models that are relevant to DAP. And IPA has a different protocol shape that doesn't actually quite fit the architecture.
Should we take more questions or should we continue?
Take the one more. Go ahead.
Yeah, okay. This is Haiguang from Huawei. I have one simple question is, in this figure, the client has two colors. One is in yellow and green. May I know what's the meaning of these different colors?
Yeah, so the green elements means they're honest, and the yellow ones means they're controlled by attackers.
So.
And from yeah.
Yeah. What I mean is, for example, is there any upper bound for the number of the ratio of the client that is not honest, yeah, for you to get the correct answer.
Yeah, so the ideal epsilon is typically achieved by like a certain batch size number of honest clients. Here we basically sketch out the three honest clients and one aggregators. They can together, by adding noise together, they can achieve the ideal epsilon DP, but when only one honest client is present, then we'll achieve a much weaker epsilon prime DP.
Then how does the, for example, aggregator or collector knows the accuracy of the results?
You mean the utility of the from adding noise or?
Yeah, because
or the privacy aspect.
Yeah, I mean, because there are some number of the clients that is not honest, they may give you false data. So when the collector gets the data, so how do they know the data is accurate or not? Means there any measurement of this accuracy of the output?
That's sort of a different problem than what I think.
Okay.
Junya is talking about here, right, Junya?
Yeah, I think typically it depends on our deployment. Like if your deployment can have, let's say, client authentication, you have a rough idea of like how many clients are under attacker's control, but here we basically we just describe like if you have a certain number of honest clients, then you get the privacy you want. But if certain number of them are corrupted, then you can still achieve a weaker epsilon guarantee.
So the epsilon here is about the privacy offered to the client, not about the accuracy of the measurement.
Okay.
We're looking at a different kind of variable.
Okay. I will discuss offline with the order. Thank you very much.
All right. Go ahead, Junya.
Kunal and Shen, I think I have raised hands. But...
Yeah, Kunal, are you?
No, I'm okay.
I can just put it in the chat. Nothing super urgent. Yeah.
Thanks.
I'll continue. I think we'll start at slide 9. This is slide 8. Yeah, okay. So the second section of this draft defines DP mechanisms, which are responsible for sampling noise with parameters derived based on the target DP. Some examples include discrete Laplace and discrete Gaussian that can generate vectors of random signed integers, and symmetric rapport that can randomly flip bits in a bit vector. An important goal of this section is to standardize DP mechanisms to prevent implementation bugs that can break DP. Next slide, please. The third section of this draft defines DP policies, which are implemented with one or more DP mechanisms and are composed with VDAFs to indulge VDAFs with DP. The diagram on the right-hand side summarizes how our current VDAF execution looks like. Next slide, please. And a concrete DP policy basically applies DP mechanisms on clients' measurements and applies DP mechanisms on aggregators' aggregate shares. Eventually, the aggregate result will be debiased if required by the DP mechanism. The DP mechanisms applied by all honest parties provide the DP guarantee. Next slide, please. And the last section of this draft aims to define a number of use cases that can be made differentially private on DAP. In the first version of this draft, we describe a use case of collecting histogram, where each client submits a bit vector with exactly one bit set, or a so-called one-hot vector. We describe two DP policies that can achieve the same epsilon delta DP. We compare them from the trust models they target, the DP mechanisms they use, and the VDAFs they're composed with. The first policy uses the pure client randomization mechanism that targets the OAMC trust model, where each honest client applies symmetric rapports to its one-hot vector, which turns it into a multi-hot vector. For verification and aggregation, we use a private VDAF called Pro3 multi-hot histogram that can check for a bounded number of ones in the noise client vector. And with certain batch size of honest clients, we can achieve the desired epsilon delta DP. The second policy uses pure aggregator randomization mechanism that targets the more stringent OAOC trust model. Each honest aggregator applies discrete Gaussian to its aggregate share before outputting it to ensure epsilon delta DP. For robustness and aggregation, we use Pro3 histogram that can check for the one hotness in the client measurements. Next slide, please. We also compare the utility of both policies in terms of standard deviation under different epsilon delta settings. Standard deviation is a good way to evaluate how different the noise count is from the true count. And the smaller the standard deviation, the better utility we can usually get. We discovered that either policy has utility advantage under different epsilon delta DP settings. And we also note that in the policy with pure aggregator randomization, the aggregator noise is doubled in a DAP setting with two aggregators in order to maintain the OAOC trust model. Next slide, please.
Ben is about the slide. Ben wants to ask you a question about the slide.
Yeah,
Junior. Oh, sure.
I was a little bit confused looking at this comparison of two approaches. At least to me, it would seem like one of the key variables we would want to vary is the batch size. I think all of these have a fixed N at like 100,000. So I would expect that like as the batch size is very large, your central DP may be better, you know, maybe for smaller, more moderate ones. I understand the privacy amplification has a big impact, like it helps in this local model, but I just wanna see like, what if we vary N quite a bit more? Like how does the comparison look?
So basically we fix the goal here to achieve the central epsilon delta DP. The batch size is like a internal variable we use in policy one with pure client randomization. Basically we say each client applies certain epsilon local DP, and with this many of number of honest clients, we can get the central epsilon delta DP.
Okay, but like what would you do if you had a batch size of like 10 million?
I think the utility you certainly waste a lot of it will be certainly very privacy friendly because you have a lot of clients, but I think you also achieve a much stronger privacy which you don't really have to, so it's sort of like a waste of privacy budget.
Yeah, I guess that's kind of my main concern in the comparison is that of a really large batch size, you might be better off with the pure aggregator approach. I just want to make sure that like we keep kind of different kind of size regimes in mind with that.
Certainly, yeah. That's why I think we'll have to rely on the minimum batch sizing DAP to sort of ensure the privacy and utility there. Shannon, Kunal.
Yeah, just a quick comment. So I think the batch size here fixed at 100,000 is basically assuming that's the min batch size that we're going to use for a task. We can do comparison with much larger batch sizes and smaller batch sizes. I think the conclusion, if I remember correctly, for pure client randomization for batch size close to a million, it actually has a better utility than the pure aggregator randomization. Yeah.
Yeah, maybe another answer to Ben's question. I think if we have a much larger batch, we can adjust the amount of local noise that each client adds so that we get the same epsilon in the end. So we don't really have to kind of waste privacy budget. I guess just the trade-off is that if you have really large batch size, the local privacy each client gets will be worse. But on aggregate, we can get the same kind of central privacy.
Okay, yeah, that makes sense. Thanks.
Shen?
Oh, sorry, I'm done.
Okay. There's still a ton of work to do. For example, we need to work out the implementation details of various DP mechanisms. We want to figure out if there are other quantitative and qualitative criteria to evaluate various DP policies. We also want to figure out if it's worth exploring MPC protocols for aggregators to collectively add noise to improve utility. And we want to describe more concrete use cases to motivate DP on DAP. Next slide, please. So this concludes all my presentation. We feel this work is important and that PPM is well positioned to take it on. Our main questions are, is this work useful? And is the draft scoped properly? And if there are other suggestions, and should PPM adopt this draft? Thank you.
Tim?
Thanks. Thanks for this presentation, Junia, as well as all your work on all this. So I support this work. I think like this is useful and PPM should do it, but there is one I think there's one question about like the audience for this work that we have to be clear on. This is echoing something I was talking about earlier during Chris Patton's presentation. I think we got to be clear about like, do we expect that the differential privacy document and like guidelines, whatever that we publish, sorry, that the PPM working group publishes, do we expect that this is only going to be usable by organizations that employ talented cryptographers? If so, are we punting the problem of like choosing good epsilons, right, to deployments? I think that's a reasonable choice, but I think we have to be crystal clear about what our expectations are of users of this stuff.
I think Chris, yeah.
So right now, yes, we're explicitly punting on like, how do you choose epsilon? I'm new to differential privacy. It's very beautiful, but it can be very, very complicated. And I think one thing we want to do with this draft is make it accessible as possible, but I don't think we're going to be able to like promise, like, here is your recipe for picking epsilon. That's like the one thing that I think is going to still be a little magical, at least until we do more research. The scope of this draft is basically to make sure big organizations that employ experts can do their best work. We want to make sure that happens. But hopefully, one of the results of that work will feed back into the IETF and add like differential privacy as another tool that we can use to make the internet better. So I'm hopeful that will fall out at the end, but initially it is not our goal to pick epsilon, except maybe Kunal is gonna say something different.
So yeah, for what it's worth, I agree with Chris Patton, because it's already technically very challenging to like do something that is implementable at all that even works. I think it would be too much for this working group to take on like generally, I don't know, providing guidelines for how to tune differential privacy. Maybe the IETF should do that, because there's a lot of things that IETF is going to work on in the coming years that probably want to use differential privacy. And like, it'd be really nice if there were some good general solutions to this, but I don't think PPM should take on that responsibility. And in any case, like even differential privacy aside, there's already like a number of parameters, the minimum batch size being the best example, that are like choosing them well is crucial to the privacy of the overall system. And we are currently like punting those choices to deployments and implementations. So I think that's fine. Okay, other thing I wanted to say, Nick Doty raised this in the chat, and I think I flagged it also in the mailing list when this draft got circulated. I think right now this document this is like an IETF procedural point sort of. So right now the draft is, I think it's informational, and I'm honestly not sure whether this needs to be informational. Like, I don't think it wants to be experimental, but I'm not sure if like informational or normative is appropriate here, because I feel like this is going to spell out some nuts and bolts, like here's the code you need to go write to go do differential privacy. So is informational appropriate?
Probably standards track is appropriate if multiple people are gonna implement it.
And I believe like multiple people would have to implement this for the aggregators to be able to like correctly jointly compute differential privacy.
There will be multiple implementations.
Sure. Kunal, best practice is to leave video off until it's your turn to get in the queue, just so that other people's streams are smaller. Simon.
Yeah, I just want to say also support this, and I also like Benjamin's suggestion of adding another dimension for the batch size. And yeah, because I think people will use different batch sizes, so the trade-offs will be different. And also for the central versus local DP, it might be good to consider that the aggregators might choose the batch and therefore the batch size. And then it would be useful to make that call later. And so it would be, so I'm in favor of working on MPC central DP.
Shen.
Hey, yeah, so what I want to say. So the document, I think the scope of the document so far is to define the mechanism and the policies for implementing DP on DAP. I agree the fine tuning of the parameters, epsilons, we can work out later. mostly from experience. And also, like someone said, the batch size sometimes is the deciding factor, because your batch size might be depending on your population size. So if your population doesn't reach a million, then you can't really choose a million minimum batch size. And based on that, we can then tune the local parameter, local differential privacy parameter to get the desired aggregator DP epsilon.
Agreed. I think we can certainly add more considerations on the batch size and the local DP we'll add.
Hi, Martin. Do you want to be in the queue?
Yeah, I think this needs a little more time to bake.
Thank you, Martin. Do you want to let it bake without it being a working group document specifically? Is that what you're saying? Yes, I see nodding.
Yeah.
So I think we have a lot of options here, and getting a little more certainty about what people want to deploy would be, I think, what I'd like to see happen. That said, I'm not opposed to it becoming a working group if everyone else thinks it's a good idea, because I very, very, very much want this general thing to be solved. It's just I want to get a bit more clarity about like what the parameters are and the requirements.
Do you want it? Would it matter to you if it's an informational document instead?
I'm not sure that an informational document necessarily gets us what we need at this point.
All right. Kunal?
So I think I agree that there's a lot of options at this point, and I think it's somewhat complicated by the fact that I think different use cases, different applications will need different versions of DP, different neighborhood relations. So I think we should really think of DP as I want to use cryptography rather than I want to use RSA. So I don't think we'll get to a point where we get one clear specification, this is exactly the way to use DP. Because every use case is different. Like if you want to aggregate bounded Euclidean norm vectors, you want to use a Gaussian mechanism. If you want to aggregate histograms, you want to use a rapport or one of the other mechanisms. And I guess the kind of DP guarantee you want may be different in multiple cases. So I think the approach this draft takes is get started on some specific use cases where we know what we want to do, or we have at least some good suggestions on what to do, but I don't think we'll ever get to a place where we have one draft that says, this is how you do DP.
Thank you, Kunal. Closing, go ahead, last comment.
So yeah, I think I agree with Kunal. The point I wanted to make is that the kind of the primary value of this document is kind of establishing the shape of this, like, defining the problem and establishing the shape of the solution and coming up with a few simple like tools to put in our tool bag. It's not going to cover every possible instantiation of DP in DAP. In particular, many of us are interested in thinking about like how we do this in MPC. I think this could be yet another draft. It could be, we can think of it perhaps as an extension to DAP. But yeah, we definitely don't want this to be the end all, the only thing you can do. This is just kind of a starting point.
Okay. Let's move on to the next topic. Shan, you ready?
Yeah.
Great.
Cool, thank you. Do I have control of the slides? I think I do.
You do, and yeah. We do not see your video. If you want to be on video, you can do that. That's your option.
Okay, now you should see me. Right, task proof. So last talk is about this inbound task provision extension. We have presented this in IETF 114. We got a lot of feedbacks. So this is the second pass. I think today I will focus more on the motivation rather than the implementation details. So a quick word on why we need this. This is one method to provide an automated mechanism for provisioning a DAP task among clients and aggregators. As you all know, today DAP, the core protocol, does not specify a standard method for doing autoban task configuration. So this extension is aiming to fill in the gap. And a few changes since the last time we presented this, we updated to fit the latest DAP and VDAP standards. And also we moved the payload of the task config object from the extension, which used to be part of the report, to the HTTP header. And this is to address a waste of bandwidth issue, especially when we send the same task config between leader and helper. Sorry, I realized I should have moved on to this slide first. So just quickly describe the task config object, because we're going to talk about it in the next few slides. Basically, it's a collection of all the configurations and the parameters required to config a DAP task. That includes all the VDAP configurations, the query configs, and all the endpoints for leader helpers and so on. But for the purpose of this presentation, I think we can just think of it as all the parameters you need to configure a task. Now, this is a basic flow for task proof. We have a logical entity called a task author. In reality, a task author is probably gonna be the same implementer as leader or collector. The job of the task author is to advertise a task config, send it over the wire to all the clients. Then the client could have a look at the task config and decide to opt in or not. If the client does opt in, then the client will derive the task ID with a hash of the task config object. This is what Chris have mentioned in one of the previous slides, where the task ID is basically bound to the task config. And task ID itself also is used in the AAD information. So with this operation, basically the client and the aggregator will agree on the same task config for a particular task. So after the client has got the task ID, it will upload the report along with the task config object to the leader for the task ID. And then the leader will decide to opt in. If this is a new task, then the leader will actually provision the task with all the parameters from task config. And the leader will forward the same information to helper in the aggregate init flow. The task config will be sent in the header file of the HTTP request, and helper will do the same thing to opt in and provision the task. So here, Tim has mentioned previously, there is still one bit of autoband configuration between the leader and helper. That is a VDAF verify key init. It's kind of a secret between leader and helper where the client shouldn't know. Therefore, it's still shared between the leader and helper, but it's a secret shared with very low frequency. Let's say once a day or once a month. It's not once per task. So just to quickly go through some key properties, and hopefully this will explain why it's useful, at least from my perspective. So one key property is we are binding the task ID with task config. For the client, this is better transparency and auditing, because the client knows the task is contributing to will be configured with the exact configurations it has seen. And for the aggregators, we can mitigate the cross-protocol attack. So what that means is the leader could tell helper these are the parameters to configure a task. Let's say it could decide the minmax size is only 10. The helper would configure that, but then the leader could advertise the task parameters with a much bigger batch size to the client. The client would not know the task 0123 is contributing to actually has a much smaller minmax size agreed by the aggregators. With task proof, we can mitigate this because the leader and helper have to use the same task config parameters, otherwise it will be it will not be able to find the same task ID. Another property I think is desirable. This is mostly operational because task proof uses the inbound data flow. It doesn't need any autobound mechanisms. So in this diagram, let's say if my organization is the yellow one, we have three helpers with three other organizations. I also have a leader with another organization. In this example, we're going to have three different autobound provision method, unless I agree with leader one, leader two, leader three to use exactly the same autobound task provision. With task proof, there's no such concern. We just implement task proof, then it's the same method for all of them. The last one is task proof can allow some client-side flexibility in choosing the task configurations. So I think in depth, we assume all the task configs or task parameters were chosen by the servers, and the client would not have any flexibility in doing that. But just like we talked about earlier about labeling, the client setting labels into the report metadata, this is a very similar idea. The client might change its task config to choose parameters that it thinks is better for its own privacy. In this example, it might change the min byte size from 1,000 to 10,000. And if there are enough clients doing this, then we can still configure a task for these clients and collect their data using the updated privacy parameters or task parameters. This will be very hard to do from just a server point of view. So it's just the server wouldn't know what flexibility the client would need. And I think it's at least going to be very tedious to configure all these parameters. So the next one is operational considerations. So task proof, I think it's fair to say it's only suitable for some use cases. It has its own shortcomings. It has a bandwidth waste. So the task config object is uploaded with every report. If your payload, report payload is a lot smaller than task config or comparable with task config, then it's wasting a lot of bandwidth. So maybe that's not an ideal use case. So the first suitable character for a task proof deployment is payload size is way larger than task config size. So this could be a VDAF like a Prio 3 sum vector instead of a Prio 3 count. The second point is there is a relatively high cardinality of tasks. So we're going to configure thousands of tasks every day instead of one task every week. Because if you just have very few amount of tasks configured very occasionally, then it probably doesn't really matter what type of task config you choose. The third one is similar to the second key property I mentioned earlier. Like if you have multiple aggregator pairs, if the organization works with many other organizations, I think it's useful to have one automated way to configure the tasks instead of agreeing multiple ones with each every vendor. And the last one, the client can have the flexibility to ask to update task config. So I think if your deployment fits some of these 4 points, then I'd say task config should be a viable option. If your deployment doesn't have any of these characters, or only have one or two of them, then maybe task config isn't the best choice for you. Lastly, I also want to mention there is a potential attack opened by task config that is a malicious client or a cohort of malicious clients. They can pollute the aggregator storage by just uploading distinct task configs because the aggregator would not know if the task config is legit or not. It will have to provision the task and then realize it's not receiving any legit data from it. So at least it's going to be a waste of storage from the aggregator's point of view. We can have some mitigation on this. For example, the task author could sign the task config. So it will verify the same signature when it comes back to the leader or helper. Then we can only we only provision tasks that had been distributed by the task author. So last slide is just a call for adoption or not. You can find more details in the latest draft. I think we feel this is useful to not only our deployment, but maybe for many other people as well. That's why we are calling for adoption as a DAP extension. That's the end of my presentation. I'll open to questions. So Simon is the first one.
Yeah, so I understand that you want to do this automatically. I don't understand exactly why you want to do it in band. Like if the task author as a thought experiment would just send the first report for each task to the aggregators, the tasks would be automatically created. And from that point on, all the clients could leave out the extra payload of the defining the task. I mean, I understand why you want to have a standardized API for creating tasks. I don't understand why you want to do it inline.
Yeah, I think doing it inline has a few benefits where you can also achieve similar benefits by having an auto-bound task proof with a lot of other add-ons. So doing it inbound, we can have the task parameter, let's say task parameter authentication property, which we have mentioned earlier.
Yeah, but as discussed then, we could do that for free without including them, as long as everybody knows what they are.
Yes, agree. We could achieve all the characters of task proof, maybe except the point where we need some flexibility from the client to set their own labels. But you could produce another extension with labeling. But I think one appealing part of task proof is it's one way of doing all this together with one inbound mechanism, with some trade-offs, like the complexity of permissioning on demand and some waste of bandwidth. But you achieve all these points in one method. You don't have to define a separate autoband interface. Today, there isn't a standard way of doing that. If you're telling me there we can do it autoband, that's true, but depending on which vendor we work with, we might have different proposals for different autoband configuration.
Yeah, agreed. So I'm just thinking it might be better to have a different one. I like your point that you could actually have the clients decide on which tasks to create in your proposal. Is that something that you're actually planning on using?
Yes.
Thank you.
This is Sam, not as chair. It's more of a question for Chris Patton sitting in front of me. To what degree does this solve issue 500 in DAP of making sure everyone's agreed on your tasks?
My opinion is that it solves it completely and pretty elegantly. I think there's reasons why if you wanted this feature, you might do it a different way. So one thing that we want to do in this is we're also encoding like DP parameters. And like one option is, you know, don't add DP. But if not everyone's going to implement DP at least right away, then yeah. So I can see. I think there's arguments. I see lots of reasons why someone would not do this, but I do think it's sufficient for that issue.
Ben.
Hi, Ben Schwartz. As individual, is this safe? Because it seems like I can, vend through the system a unique task config to each user in the population and create a tracking identifier that follows that user around. Even if I can't get the value associated with it, I can just see, you know, which user or when a user is submitting a task ID that it is unique to that user. That's something that is largely avoided in the models where the task configs essentially are pinned into the source code, and we assume that the source code is basically audited.
to do that, you need to have the ability to target a user with a particular task config.
So it creates linkability. It raises a bunch of configuration consistency questions, which have also come up in Privacy Pass and OHTTP.
So how do you track one user by sending a unique task config? Like how do you target the user?
So there's a, even if you don't have an explicit link to some other aspect of that user's identity, although you might, there's, as far as I know, there's nothing here that talks about the rules about the transport over which you can provide the task configuration. Even if you don't have that, you still have the ability to watch individual users across time as they submit reports, even if you don't exactly know who those users are.
But the task proof makes that situation worse, or is that an existing attack you can already do with any data report uploading? Like assuming we don't have OHTTP to mask the user's source IP.
I think I just wanted to raise the issue, and yes, it depends on, certainly if you don't have any user, if you don't have any additional identity protection for the user, then there are other ways that this could leak.
Tim, now we are over time, but
So let's see. Okay, so first off, whenever task prompt gets discussed over the months and years, there's often a lot of talk about transparency and auditing and so on. And I see the merit in that, and of course, especially in like a system that's all about privacy. But one thing I want to stress here, and you know, as the draft makes clear and as the authors have been consistent about saying, is that like aggregators, like this still only works in assuming that at least one of the aggregators is honest, right? So point being, the aggregators can like do the derivations and the task config hashing and so on with a certain set of parameters, but still like use a different one. What I really want to stress here is that like this is not certificate transparency, right? It does not provide guarantees of at a similar level. And so I want everybody to be, and again, I know that the authors know this and I've been very clear about that, but I want to make sure the whole working group gets that like this does not buy you web PKI levels of like auditability. Past that, I have like a couple of points about the design task prop itself, but given that we're over time, I think I'll take those to the list. I'll expand on the email list, but I'm interested in exploring whether we could do this in an HPKE config instead of the upload path. And also I'm curious about like, what if I have multiple partners that I'm doing task prof with, like, and I have, but I'll follow up in email. Thanks.
Chris Patton, you wanna go ahead?
Tim, I'm very interested to hear your ideas about how to improve this. What was I going to say? Oh, I just wanted to respond to Ben. I don't understand the concern about like track, like I don't understand the tracking concern because it doesn't reveal to any information about the client being leaked. Something that core dApp does not hide is the fact that someone is participating in the protocol. That's not in our threat model. So it's just about protecting the data.
Okay, so in part, I want to get a sense of the room about adopting this now or not. But I have a different administrative question, which is our charter doesn't let us do provision of measurements. It assumes that's done out of band. And here we have a way of doing it in band elegantly that also serves other purposes. If we're going to adopt it, do I need to go get the AD to approve a charter change? And the AD is not in the room. Silence. I love it.
Well, if you want an opinion, then let's change the charter if we have to and adopt it. And let's do that on list.
It seems like a pretty simple change. It's just saying like, and we'll specify mechanisms for provisioning tasks as needed.
I want to do a quick hum. I'm going to use the polling tool. I'm making the question really brief, which is, do you support adopting this draft? I know we'll have to take it to the list, but I do want to get us into the room. All right. I'll keep collecting those for a few minutes. Otherwise, go enjoy your cookies. Thanks for a great meeting.
Thank you, everyone.
Thanks, Shan, for the presentation.
So I think you're right about that. Yes, one's a double.